Okay, then let's go ahead and start. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, salatu wassalam ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. Last week we spoke about the Buyids and then the Mongols and the havoc that the Mongols spread around the Muslim world. And today I want to talk about Ibn Taymiyyah because he was living during this time. And what I want to look at in terms of Ibn Taymiyyah, why I want to present him isn't particularly to promote his positions, theological or fiqh positions, but rather to introduce or to elaborate on the project of Ibn Taymiyyah. And everyone here has probably heard of the name. I'm sure everyone here has heard Ibn Taymiyyah or Shaykh Islam Ibn Taymiyyah. Why is that? Well, when you look at history from the time he was alive until now, Ibn Taymiyyah wasn't as popular as he is now. Right, so the question is why? Why did all of a sudden the past two or three decades did he gain so much popularity? Whereas previous times he was known, but he wasn't this authoritative figure outside of the Hanbali school of thought, because he's a Hanbali. So Ibn Taymiyyah, born in 1263, died in 1328. He's kind of like a halfway point in terms of our history up until now. So before him, there's 700 years of Islam, and after him, until our time today, there's 700 years. He's this kind of midway point. So let's look at his project. How did he approach Islam, and how did he present Islam? I'm not presenting this in any particular order, so this isn't, I'm showing the most important things first, not, I'm just putting it as it came through my mind. Ibn Taymiyyah had a bottoms-up approach, whereas scholars had a top-down approach, meaning Islam, from a top-down approach, starts with the Khilafah, the caliphate, and those running the caliphate, which include the scholars, right? Not that these scholars were part of the political agenda, but they were of the top, they were of the elites in this regard. They had authority in this regard. So it was coming from up, and the people on top, they're the ones who built the rest of Islam, or the rest of Muslim society. Now, by the time Ibn Taymiyyah comes out, by the time he's born, and he gains his prominence, the Khilafah is pretty much destroyed. Baghdad has been sacked, right? The eastern part of the Muslim world is in complete chaos because of the Mongols, right? There was a period of time, a few years, where there was no Khalifa. It was 3 years, I believe. There was no Khalifa. The Muslims were very disunited. So this idea of a top-down structure was simply impossible during his time. It was irrelevant. You cannot do a top-down. So he approaches it bottom-up. It's we, the Muslims, right? We, the society, the Muslim people, we are the ones who need to work towards establishing the Khilafah and establishing Islam. You start from the bottom and you build your way up. So one of the reasons why he is so relative and important in our times is because we are in a very similar situation. There is no Khilafah. There hasn't been a Khilafah for about 100 years now. The Ummah is very divided. You have all these countries, nation states, right? Although the numbers of nation states today, countries today, were less than the amount of sultanates during the time of Ibn Taymiyyah, but you still see that relationship. Right? The institutions of Islam were pretty much destroyed with colonialism, and we'll talk about that once we get there. So during his time, right, there is just absolute chaos. They needed to rebuild the Ummah. So Ibn Taymiyyah comes from a paradigm where we can relate to what he is saying in that regard. We can understand his mission, and it's very relative to what we are trying to do today. It is the Muslims who are trying to reestablish Islam. We are not looking to the kings or the heads of state to reestablish Islam. Quite the contrary, we see them as one of the greatest challenges when it comes to reestablishing Islam. And among his project was that he looked at the formative period, what's called in Arabic the Salaf al-Salih. You've heard of this term, the Salaf al-Salih, right? Which referred to the first 3 centuries of Islam, first 300 years of Islam. So this is the time of the Sahaba, the Tabi'in, the Tabi'a Tabi'in, the time of the four Imams, the time of Bukhari, Muslim, these heroes and these high authoritative figures when it comes to Islam. We look to them, how they approached Islam, the fatwas they gave, the approach to Islam that they gave, and we use that to critique the 300 years after. So Ibn Taymiyyah is born in 600 and 6 something, Hijra. So he's using the first 300 years to critique the following 300 years. And saying that these first three generations, these first 300 years, are the best. According to who? According to the Prophet, عليه الصلاة والسلام. خير القرون قرني ثم الذين يلونهم ثم الذين يلونهم. The best of generations is my generation, then those who follow, and then those who follow. How much is a generation? Well, according to Imam Ahmad and others, it's 100 years. Why? Because the Prophet ﷺ was walking by a companion, a child. He put his hand on his head and said, يَعِيشُ الْغُلَامُ قَرْنًا. This boy will live for a generation, a qarn. And that sahabi passed away at 100 years. So some scholars took a qarn to mean 100 years. So the first 300 years, the Prophet ﷺ praised them. And that's very clear. When you look at the people there, the structure, the power, the might of the Muslims during these 300 years, it was very different than the following 300 years. So he uses them to critique the next 300 years. So this whole term, we see as Salaf al-Salih. We got to go back to the Salaf and look at that. They're taking it from Ibn Taymiyyah, but Ibn Taymiyyah was engaged in this at a much deeper level. Right? How did Imam Ahmad, how did Imam Shafi'i, how did Imam Malik, how did Hassan al-Basri and all these people, how did they approach Islam? Because when we talk about the Mamluks, there are some major differences that occur. So we mentioned last week that the madrasas were introduced to the Muslim world by the Seljuks. And although the madrasas came with its advantages, came with its good, there were also some concerns. And that is, this whole following a curriculum, although it's effective in developing a student, right, it limits the amount of, unintentionally, limited the amount of critical thinking that, or independent thinking that a Muslim exerts in order to come to a conclusion. Now, last week, the idea of ijtihad was mentioned. Inshallah, if I remember, I'll talk about that during the time of colonialism when you get to figures like Muhammad Rashid Rida and Muhammad Abdu. Because they tried reviving this, and sometimes it's really taken out of context and misunderstood. Another major concern of Ibn Taymiyyah was reviving the ummah feeling and sentiment. That we are a ummah, we are a people who feel for one another. And therefore, we should be concerned with the affairs of other Muslims. We are not just people who, the scholars, as I mentioned, they became professors. Where do you find scholars? In the madrasa. Just like today, where do you find scholars? At the universities. What are the scholars doing? They're just sitting there in the universities doing their research. Right? It's rare to find a professor who's actually engaging society, who's active in social matters. Someone like Noam Chomsky, for example. Right? He's very active when it comes to social and political needs and concerns. And therefore, the students really look up to him. Why? Because now he's enacting his knowledge, and not just researching and saying, hey, this is all theoretical, and here you go. Look at what I have to say. Right, so he's reviving the ummah feeling. We are an ummah, and we are concerned with one another, and that manifests itself many times during his life. And amongst that is, or building off the previous slide, is he encouraged the direct engagement of the Quran. Right, now some people today try doing that without the credentials. This is not what I'm talking about here. What Ibn Taymiyyah is trying to do is saying that when we try and observe or discuss a particular issue, the first and foremost evidence that we need to look to is the Quran itself. Okay, weren't all these other scholars doing that? Yeah, but not as clearly. Scholars tended to be more concerned with gathering hadith and the opinions of companions. Why? Because hadith was an area that was attacked. It required a lot of scholarship to discipline it and present it in a way where it prevents fake hadith, fabricated hadith, from entering Islamic discourse, as well as prevent those who are trying to, use hadith in certain manners, etc. So their concern was more about gathering hadith. It was very prominent if a person had a lot of hadith memorized, or they were part of an isnad. So they were concerned with that, and they tended to look at the opinions of companions. To give you an example, establishing leadership. Right, what is the evidence that the Muslims need a leader? Need a khalifa? Well, the companion or the scholars would say the companions had unanimous consensus that we need to have a leader above us, or for us. Because when the Prophet ﷺ died, they refused to bury the Prophet ﷺ until they chose a leader to lead them. So the ijma' of the Sahaba is the evidence that they use. Ibn Taymiyyah says, no, we got to look to the Qur'an. And how the Qur'an looks at this information, therefore we are able to navigate the topic instead of presenting it in a stiff manner. Right? The companions, there's consensus, and that's it. Right? No, how does the Qur'an approach? So if you remember when I spoke about it briefly, and Ibn Taymiyyah has a book about this, and I'll talk about, right? The Islam presents politics in a very, and not in a very structured manner, but presents principles. If you remember this in the earlier sessions, right? It presents principles and guidelines. This is what you have. Now you go ahead and build the structure of government that is suitable for your time and place. So Ibn Taymiyyah is saying, no, let's look at the Qur'an first, how it presents it, and then it'll help us better understand the opinions and the actions of the companions themselves. Because when the companions did this, right, when they felt that they needed to have a leader, well, it was based on what they know of Qur'an and Hadith, or the sayings of the Prophet ﷺ. So with that, you find that Ibn Taymiyyah was, he was able to challenge a few of the, what became status quo. Right? Now, he's not challenging consensus. Not at all. Ibn Taymiyyah, I've read it in my own two eyes. He says that if someone, this is my opinion, if someone has said it before me. Meaning if no one has preceded me in this opinion, then my opinion has absolutely no value, throw it out. So Ibn Taymiyyah would never go against consensus, right? Nor would he ever invent a new opinion. But he was brave enough to look at opinions that have been lost from the Salaf themselves. And a primary example of that is when it comes to talaq, divorce. So the four madhabs all say that if a man says, you are divorced three times, talaq, 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 or I have divorced you three times and with one, right? That's three divorces, the marriage is nullified, and they cannot get remarried until the wife marries someone else, right? Ibn Taymiyyah says, no. This is the opinion that changed because of certain conditions and certain realities. During the time of Umar radiallahu anh, when you look at the Qur'an presents it in a way where the talaq must be in different settings in order for it to be more than one talaq, right? Now he was arrested for this. He was arrested by the scholars. They said he is going against ijma'. And he has a book, actually it's four volumes, talking about this issue, saying that there's no ijma' on this. There are scholars before us, preceded us, who said the same opinion, right? So he was brave enough to try and revive certain opinions that are beneficial to the ummah. And Ibn Qayyim comments on this and says that when Umar radiallahu anh made this ruling, he was doing it to tighten something that people were taking advantage of. So you'd find a man would start harassing his wife and saying, you divorced three times. They're playing around with the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly states in the Quran how to go about doing talaq. And people were ignoring that and taking advantage of it. So Umar radiallahu anh, to prevent people from playing around with the rules of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, anyone who says talaq three times, then it is three times. Right? So that was to prevent a harm that was occurring because of people. Ibn Qayyim says, nowadays, this occurs so much, what ends up happening is the following. A guy says it, they get the fatwa that they are divorced, they don't want to leave each other, and then it leads to zina, it leads to fornication. So we should revert back to the original opinion, right, of the Prophet ﷺ and Abu Bakr in the first 2 years, I believe, of the time of Umar radiallahu anh, that talaq must occur at different settings in order for it to be more than one talaq. Right? So he's brave enough to do that, and he paid the price for that. He also use the strategy of Imam, or the approach of Imam Shafi'i, of reconciling between differing opinions when possible. So when you read his works and the works of his student Ibn Qayyim, you find this a lot. Scholars differ in a certain area. What's better? What's more pious and what's more rewarding? Having patience, being tested and having patience, or being comfortable in life but being grateful. What is better? And the scholars debate. This is better. This is better. And they have arguments and whatnot. It's very spiritual when you look at these arguments, how they view the Sharia, how they view the Quran, because it gives you elements of what to appreciate when it comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibn Qayyim says, no, we can combine the two opinions. and say that one isn't inherently better than the other, but rather the one who is able to enact it more than the another person, that's the better one. And for example, we have two people. One is has comfort and is grateful, and one is being tested and is patient. Who is better? They are equal unless one of them is exerting and doing more ibadah as a result. So if one person, because of his test, being tested, they are reaching out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are excelling and coming closer to Allah more than the grateful one, then they're better. So you see how they reconcile between the two opinions. And this goes back to Imam al-Shafi'i. Another example of that is Sufism, right, versus the Fuqaha. The Fuqaha had a very fiqh-oriented understanding of Islam, right? These are the laws. This is how we enact it. And as a result, some would ignore the spiritual side. So fiqh is meant to deal with our realities. Spirituality, tazkiyah, Sufism, is meant to look inward and deal with the inward realities, right? So you find that there's tension between these two realms. So Ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn Qayyim, they are able to reconcile, saying that we need both, but both need to be disciplined by Quran and Sunnah. Therefore, we accept the good of Sufism, that which is in line with Quran and Sunnah, and we leave that which is not. Likewise, when it comes to fiqh, we accept that which is in line with Quran and Sunnah, and we leave that which is not. What's not in line with the fuqaha? Well, sometimes this very dry approach to Islam leads to obsessive compulsion disorder. So maybe you've seen people making wudu. They make wudu once, they dry themselves, and they go make wudu again, right? And then they make wudu again. Or when they do takbirah, Allahu Akbar. No, they leave prayer, Allahu Akbar. And they leave prayer, Allahu Akbar, right? This is obsessive compulsion disorder that the fuqaha spoke about. Sometimes a person becomes so obsessed with applying the fiqh, right, that they develop this. And in Arabic, it's called al-waswas al-qahhar, right, an overpowering whisper, which we today call obsessive compulsion disorder. And Ibn Taymiyyah, among his, of course, his primary goal was to call people back to tawheed, to monotheism. So when you look at Ibn Taymiyyah, his da'wah, his call, his message is worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught us to and told us to, through the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and through the Quran. He's very much adamant about that. And he talks a lot about the excessiveness of certain Sufi groups and certain heretical groups. So he's very much adamant about that. So why is Ibn Taymiyyah so popular today? I mentioned that his approach to Islam and Islamic activism is very relevant to today's needs, right? His times are similar to our own, and I mentioned that. He was more than a scholar, but a socio-political activist. And by engaging society and engaging politics or politicians, he was able to understand the world in a deeper, more insightful way than other fuqaha who don't have experience in these realms. And as a result, he was able to produce fatwas that were more effective, more accurate, right? And brought about greater results than other fuqaha. An example of that is during the time of the Mongols. If you remember, the Ilkhans, and a lot of these Mongols became Muslim. So the Golden Horde in what's today Kazakhstan and the parts of Russia, they became Muslim, and the Ilkhans in Iran and Khurasan became Muslims as well. However, the Ilkhans kept advancing. They wanted to take lands. So they were about to enter Syria and Damascus and take it. And they, the Mongols, the army, would send messages to the inhabitants of Damascus and one of these cities and say, your previous leaders were unjust and they did crimes. We're coming here to free you, along these lines. So what he was saying was true. They were unjust. But Ibn Taymiyyah questioned the second part of their claim. We're coming to free you. Now, you have these forces coming, right? And they claim to be Muslim, and they claim to be coming to free Muslims and defeat the unjust rulers. Now, the four shuyukh, the four imams of the four madhabs, right? Because each city, as I mentioned last week, there was a top authority for each of the madhabs, right? When they heard about this coming, what do? Do we fight back or not? The four schools said that, no, we don't fight back because they're Muslims. We can't fight back. Ibn Taymiyyah says, no, we need to fight them. It is an obligation upon us to fight them. Why? Because Ibn Taymiyyah engaged them. And we all maybe have heard of the story where he went to the general of the army, him himself, he went to meet him, right? And he was cooking something, and the general said, "Here, why don't you eat?" He said, "No, I refuse to." "Why do you refuse to?" "Because you stole the wood that you're using to cook the meal from the Muslims. And that's not something permissible." And he told them, he convinced the general not to enter Damascus. From his engagement, right, he even theorized that the Mongols were conspiring with the Crusaders. And what's interesting is modern research suggests the same thing. There are some documents that have been unveiled that, I guess, conversation going on between the Mongols, the Ilkhans, and the Crusaders. They're conspiring against the Muslims. So because he was socio-politically active, he was able to understand the realities. He engaged with the Ilkhans, and he understood them. He understood that the followers of these individuals tended to be from the worst and the most heretical of Islamic groups, the philosophers, the Rafida, right, the Qadaris, a lot of the Ghulat from the Sufis, the extreme Sufis. They were the ones who were following these people. Well, this guy is hoarding or gathering around him the worst of the worst, the most heretical of Muslims. How can he claim to be coming to free us when the people following him are problematic in the first place? So he's able to get that insight through his socio-political activism. And an example of his activism was he advocated jihad against the Mongols. He went to the emirs, right, the princes and the leaders of Damascus, and started saying, "We have to fight." He encouraged them, "We have to fight. Get up and do something." And he was successful in doing that, right? So that's why he's so relevant to our times today. Now, he has a book called As-Siyasa Shar'iyya, Political Science of the Sharia. And in it, as I mentioned, the Khilafah had collapsed and it's pretty much destroyed. And the Khalifa was pretty much symbolic. He was there, but just as a symbol. People running the affairs were the sultans. Right? So he is trying to understand how to present Islam to a world where present the Khilafah to a world where the Khilafah is destroyed. And he's asked this question, right? How do we deal with this? This caused him to reimagine the Caliphate as a whole. And some of the main points of that, of his book, is that the Khalifa, so if you remember the Venn diagram that I showed us several sessions ago, where you had the political realm, and then you had the religious realm, and between was the Supreme Court. You remember this? Right? So what this means is that they had different roles and functions in society, where the fuqaha, they were the legislators. The khalifa or the sultan had no authority in legislating law, except what has to do with these things. The khalifa or the sultan was responsible for five functions in society: the military, the economy, right, such as collecting zakah and distributing zakah, the penal system, the penal law. So if someone is convicted of a crime, it is the government that enacts a punishment. A public interest. So that which is irreligious but has to do with the well-being of the society. For example, an example of this today is the rules of the road. Does it have anything to do with religion? No, it has to do with organizing society. It's an irreligious matter. So the political realm deals with that. And the preservation of the rights of people. Right? So it's upon the Khalifa or the Sultan to make sure that there are institutions like the court and other things that will preserve the rights of people. So they're the ones who need to fund the courts and establish these things, but these courts are run by who? By the Fuqaha. Who is legislating the laws that go under these things? It's the Fuqaha. It is not the Khalifa who says, "Okay, when it comes to the economy, we're going to do this." Right? No, it goes back to the realm of fiqh. So from here, what this allows to occur in greater society is that it allows religious minorities to enter society without being under the authority of religion itself. Meaning, if the Christians, for example, living in Damascus, weren't responsible for Islamic law. Why? Because their the authority above them was the Sultan, and the sultan was meant to deal with irreligious matters. Does that make sense? No. So, right, when you look at religious minorities in the Muslim world, Christians, Jews, Zoroastrians, right, anyone, anything, just put them there, right? Who are they responsible to in terms of society? Who are they legally bound by? The sultan, not the fuqaha, right? Therefore, the sultan, therefore the laws that are applied on these religious minorities are that which have to do with public interest, which are irreligious matters. They're not infringing on their religious rights. As for their religious matters, they establish their own courts and arbitration to deal with their issues. Unless, of course, a non-Muslim transgress against or commits a crime against a Muslim, then they're held by the Islamic law. Or if the non-Muslims go to a Muslim court, then they're allowed to do that as well and accept the Muslim law in terms of whatever they're going for. Does that make more sense? So what this allows is religious freedom and pluralism. Now, when you look at America or any federal system, or in fact, nation states, when nation states came about, the federal government is responsible for everyone, and everyone is bound by federal law. If the White House or the Congress passes a bill, every American, anyone on American soil, is bound by that law, irrespective of their religion, right? And since all of law goes back to this entity of politics, right? If the government passes a bill that goes against our principles, right? We can't do anything about it. When it comes to issues of marriage and divorce, there's a lot of problems that occur in our community because, well, we're bound by American law and we can't go around it. And they don't allow us arbitration. It has absolutely no value in the court of law here in America. So it creates, although there's an amount of pluralism in America, right? That pluralism is limited by what the government allows. Whereas in Islam, the government had no authority in terms of indicating or dictating religious law or legislating any law, okay? So that's why the system of Islam is very effective. Now, what occurs as a result of nation states, you know what, I'll leave that for nation states when we talk about that, when we talk about colonialism. You know, I'll say it now, so we don't forget about it. So in nation statism, as I was mentioning, when people try to apply Islam in a nation state, although theoretically it's compatible, it brings these problems with it. Okay, how is a religious political party going to apply Islamic law in a federal government or a nation state that demands every person in the state follow that law, right? So if a Muslim political entity wanted to ban alcohol, or no, let me say, for example, someone who steals, their hand is cut, well, that needs to be applied on everyone in the state, Muslim or non. Why? Because that's the way the state is built. So this brings about problems, right? That's why they call it a theocracy. These are states, if a Muslim party enters the political realm, they become a theocracy, meaning they are forcing people to follow their religion instead of their own. So this is a challenge. Now, I'm not saying it's haram for these Muslim political groups to be in politics, but I'm saying this is one of the challenges that come about because of nation states, where in the Muslim world, that simply wasn't that big of a problem, or if even a problem. And then what we take from this as well is the following. What is the role of politics in Islam? In other words, is politics and government an issue of theology or an issue of fiqh? What's the difference? Well, if it's an issue of theology, well, it has to do with iman and kufr. It has to do with belief and disbelief. Whereas if it's an issue of fiqh, it has to do with maslaha and mafsada. It has to do with best interest of people and the harms that come, bringing what's beneficial for people and diverting, deflecting, preventing that which is harmful. Right? Now, sometimes people misunderstand the political entity as being an issue of theology. And this brings a lot of problems. So for example, when you look at ISIS and Al-Qaeda, who tried to reestablish the Khilafah, you know, why are they trying to reestablish the Khilafah so adamantly? Well, because in order to apply the law of Allah, Hukmullah, right, which is an issue of theology, there needs to be a Khalifa who is doing that. So now the Khilafah has become a theological issue. And therefore, if you go against them, you are going against the Ummah. You are going against Islam. And now you're a disbeliever. Sometimes it's on the more liberal end, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has spoken so well of the sultans, right? And the sultan needs to be is kind of a representative of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. You hear some Christian groups say this. God chose you and whatnot, right? Become the theological issue. Therefore, we have to be obedient to the core, to the sultan. We hear this today, right? Ta'at wali al-amr, you know, obedience to the ruler and whatnot. It becomes so theological that where if someone goes against or starts questioning it, it's as if they are questioning iman itself. However, the truth is that politics is an issue of fiqh. And for that reason, when you look at the issues of khilafah, if you want to find khilafah, the laws and the rulings of khilafah, you find it in fiqh books under the unit or the chapter of al-bughat, the transgressors, those who try and revolt against the government. You don't even find its own separate unit or chapter. You don't find the babul khilafah or babul khalifa and whatnot. Right? Why? Because it is a fiqh issue that will change according to time and place, because the point of this, as I mentioned way back, is that the point of a government is to bring about the best interest of the people, to serve the people, to cater to the people. And that will change. The way that is applied will change from time to time. Now again, there are fundamental or unequivocal principles and guidelines that the Quran has presented, right? But that is in our best interest itself, okay? Does that make sense? Are there any questions up till now? Yes.
When you say they transgress against the society, does that also sound like they are disbelievers?
Mm-mm. Okay. So, there are two types of transgressors. There's one that transgresses against society itself, like robbers, thieves, bandits. These are called qutaa turuq, bandits. Right, these are people who will use weapons to create fear and steal or kill. Okay, the bughat, these are groups of people who are revolting against the government itself for a reason that is acceptable, understandable, I should say. Meaning, a people who are trying to revolt against the ruler because the ruler did something un-Islamic. Although we might say that they are wrong for doing that, for whatever reason, right? They still have an understandable reason for revolting. So in this unit, it has its own particular rulings. For example, it's mentioned in the Quran, وَإِن طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ اقْتَتَلَ. Right? If two groups of Muslims fight, فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا, reconcile between them. And this is tended to be used in referring to these. The incident between Muawiyah and Ali radiallahu anhu, right? They consider Muawiyah to be one of these bughat. He revolted. But why did Muawiyah revolt? Or why did he refuse to obey and give bay'ah, allegiance to Ali radiallahu anhu? Because my cousin was killed and I'm his closest relative and the Quran gives me authority. He has an understandable reason for doing it. Although we might say that, no, the better opinion, Ali was more on the truth radiallahu ta'ala anhu than Muawiyah. Does that make sense? So it's in this chapter where the fuqaha talk about the khilafah. To tell us what? It is a fiqh issue. Now, it's not a theological one. No. Okay. So with that, we enter a new phase, and that is the mamluks. Sometimes the mamluks are considered to be one of the four khulafa, the khulafa dynasties, the Umayyads, and then the Abbasid, and then the mamluks, and then the Ottomans, or some consider this to be an extension of the Abbasids, right? They rule for a little over 250 years. So if you see here, this is where we're at now. So when I was talking about Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah ta'ala, he's living when the map looks like this. You have the Ilkhanids here, right? These are the Mongols who converted to Islam. And then you have the Golden Horde over here. They also converted to Islam. And then you have the Mamluks in this area. Okay, so this is post Crusaders. Now the Crusaders have been expelled from Palestine, right? By the Ayyubids, and this is how you have it. So Anatolia, this area, all this is Mongols, and they're wreaking havoc, right? And Ibn Taymiyyah is right here. So the Ilkhanids, they wanted to come here and enter Damascus. So the origins, Mamluk means one who is owned. And the Mamluks, their origins are Turks from the Turkic region of Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, all these stands outside of Pakistan and Afghanistan, north of that, Central Asia. And these Turks were imported to the Muslim world by the Abbasid Caliphate. Now, remember, when the Abbasids are doing this, they were at the height of their power. Very powerful. This is where the civilization is. So, Turkic families would willingly send their children to become slaves of the Abbasid Caliphate. Why? Because the Abbasids would take these slaves and these children, invest much time and money in them, train them to become soldiers and educated. They become generals. And after 10 years of training and service, they would free them. They become free. So, a lot of families saw this as an opportunity. Right? So, for example, you know, people today, if America were to pass a bill where we are accepting immigrants to come to America, but for the first 10 years, you'll be a federal, you'll work for the federal government, right? And the federal government will invest in you, train you, etc. They'll pay for education. Are people going to do that? Heck yeah, they're going to do that, right? So, slavery in Islam is not like slavery in America. It's very different, and we'll talk about that perhaps when we get to the last session. So this is where the Mamluks are coming from. Many of these freed warriors would continue to build their strength and influence and become generals with enough power to execute the caliphs. So they were caliph slaves who became caliph killers. I mentioned that before. That's how powerful they became. They're not just strong, they were politically very wise. With the sacking of Baghdad, the caliphate is moved to Egypt. The ruling Ayyubids sent the Mamluks to defeat King Louis IV of France, who had occupied the coastal city of Demyat in Arabic, which is in Egypt. Back in Cairo, however, the Ayyubid Sultan passed away. His wife, Shajar ad-Durr, which literally means the tree of pearls or the pearl tree, concealed his death because her son, the successor, was part of the army that was sent. And for 6 months, she ruled on her deceased husband's behalf. This is one of the times where there was a female Muslim ruler, and she was ruling all this land. However, before her son was able to ascend the throne, the Mamluks killed him. I guess their spies told him that the king has died. This is an opportunity. So they killed him. Why? Because he favored a rival group. So the Mamluks were they had a lot of rival groups within themselves. Right? So the person, the son who was supposed to ascend the throne, become the Sultan of the Ayyubids, favored a rival group. So these murderers made Shajar the new Sultan. She ruled for a while, and then the Mamluk commander married her after a few months, which is obvious that they're the ones who killed him. Right? So the Mamluks ousted the Ayyubids and took their lands. So the Ayyubids, after Sultan, I'm sorry, after Salah ad-Din finished his jihad and exiled the Crusaders from Jerusalem, this is his land, right? When he died, it was split between his children, as I've mentioned before, how it works, and then it weakens when it's split and they become rivals, they don't help each other, and the Mamluks take advantage of this, and then they take over the Ayyubid lands. Right. Now, when it comes to Mamluk governance, nothing out of the ordinary, very similar to what we've seen in the Umayyads and the Abbasids. However, when it comes to succession, they were the worst. When the Sultan of the Mamluks would pass away, the next Sultan would be chosen by a war. The rivaling groups would fight each other, right? And then the winner would ascend the throne. Now, if you think about this is probably the worst system of succession in human history. Yet it worked for 250 years. Get that. Why? The theory is because the one who ascends the throne is by far the most capable. He won the battles, right? And now he is the kind of like lions. Lions, they duke it out, and then the stronger one is the one who becomes the leader of the pack, or leader, right? Some of the accomplishments of the Mamluks, they expelled the Crusaders from the Muslim lands. In the year, I think the last Crusaders were expelled in the year 1302, and the last major battle was in 1293. And the Mamluks were the ones who carried that out. They defeated the Mongols in Ain Janut, which marked the end of their expansion in the Muslim world. Right? So they were warriors. They're very powerful warriors. And although they were crazy in some aspects, they protected the Islam and the Muslims in other ways.
So the Mamluks, they came after the
Mongols, obviously. Their story technically begins before the Mongols. So the Mongols, the Seljuks, the Ottomans, right, the Mamluks, they're all coming from the same region. They're all cousins of one another. Right? So the Abbasids were importing these people and training them before the Mongols came. And this kind of continued. So you have this group called the Mamluks. And among the most prominent, probably the most successful, sometimes in controversial ways, was Baybars, Bunduqdari, I'm sorry, right? He's a very popular name, Zahir Baybars, Rukn al-Zahir, one of his titles. Perhaps the most successful and mightiest of the Mamluks, participating in defeating the Crusades and the Mongols, was also controversial. He was accused of killing the general of the army that defeated the Mongols. So the whole story of Shajar ad-Dur, it said that he's the one who really engineered that coup and that assassination. He kept the Khalifa powerless under his rule. Right. So there was a Khalifa, and I believe one of them was Al-Qawalun, and he was hopeless, helpless. I mean, he's just kind of there. Right, kind of like the Pope. The Pope says things and people say hi to him and whatnot, and he has his Pope mobile, as they call it. And this is a Khalifa back then, powerless, helpless. One of the things he did, and I put this under controversial because, as I'll explain now, he introduced four courts to the cities. What does that mean? It means that he introduced a court for the Shafi'is, a court for the Hanafis, a court for the Malikis, and the fourth court for the Hanbalis. Now, when you look at the dynamics of that, in some ways that's quite useful for society. In that, if a person, for example, was born and raised in a particular madhab, right? Some of our Desi brothers and sisters, very Hanafi oriented, right? And it's Hanafi all the way, and that's it, right? Now, wherever they go, there's a Hanafi court for them to go to. So they feel comfortable. Another way it's beneficial is that, part of the Sharia, part of the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that He made a lot of flexibility. He gave us a lot of flexibility. And part of the Imam al-Nawawi, for example, says, اختلاف الأمة رحمة. The differing of the Ummah, the scholars, when they differ on certain issues, it's a form of mercy. That it leaves an amount of flexibility where if a particular time demands a type of fatwa, right, it goes back to a legitimate scholar. Here in America, we cannot just take one madhab and apply it all out. We don't have the luxury to do that. Sometimes we need to pick and choose what fatwas we need to apply because that's just our reality, right? And this isn't to say we start playing around with the Sharia. No, all of these fatwas go back to legitimate scholars who took it from verses of Quran and Hadith, right? The reason why some consider this to be controversial is the following. Zahir Baybars, being a very smart politician, realized how powerful the ulama class was, right? And how much influence they had in society. So part of breaking that was introducing these four courts. Why? Because prior to this, the judge would enact ijtihad when he gave a ruling. The judge wasn't necessarily following one particular madhab. Rather, he's looking at the case. Right? He's looking at the case and realizing, okay, this is the situation, this is the fatwas that I have in hand, these are the legitimate, the valid opinions, okay, how am I going to deal with this case? So it allowed them an amount of critical thinking. Now when you have these four courts, right, each court is bound by a particular thought process, right? That's how it works. So it's said, some people theorize that he actually did this to break the strength of the scholars and the ulama, and the muftis and the judges. Because the judges were powerful. People listened to the judges, they didn't listen to the sultan.
Chicken balance. Right?
I'm sorry?
Chicken balance.
So yeah, there's a check and balance, but he's trying to break that check and balance. He's trying to give himself more authority, right, and more influence. Yes. And he was, I believe, the first person to have received the title Khadim al-Haramain al-Sharifain, the servant or the custodian of the two holy cities. So the Saudi part kings are now called Khadim al-Haramain al-Sharifain. They're not the first people to be called that. Maybe Zahir Bey was the first one. Why? Because they took it as pride. When you do Hajj and Umrah, when you visit the Medina of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, you are in Mamluk territory. The decline of the Mamluks occurred for economical reasons and not keeping up with modern times. The training programs began to weaken, become less effective. Later Mamluk sultans who were of Circassians, Sharkasis, they were weaker than the Turkic Mamluks and less effective. Wealth and power became the vision of the Mamluks, and they attempted to monopolize commerce. Create these monopolies where everyone is coming to them. And this actually created a negative reaction from society, from greater society, and from people, foreign business people. Right? People coming from foreign countries or foreign lands and doing business in the Ummah. This started to shift routes away from Cairo, thus weakening their economy. As a result, they weren't able to keep up, or they didn't care to keep up with developing technologies, as I will mention when we talk about the... Well, I'll tell you now, gunpowder. During this time, gunpowder was revolutionary. Not revolutionary in that it was being invented or was discovered during that time, but the uses of gunpowder became much more innovative. And I'll talk about that when we talk about the Ottomans. And the Mamluks, the Sultanate of the Mamluks collapsed and was defeated in 1517 by the Ottomans themselves. With that, we end the fifth unit, and inshallah, next week we'll talk about the Ottoman era. And this is definitely a very hot topic now, especially with Erdogan, mashallah, wreaking havoc in Europe. Yes, mashallah. I'm sorry?
He's talking to Trump.
He's talking to Trump now, right? And I think Muslims have a sigh of relief when they see someone who actually cares, right? Someone who's actually willing to speak up. You know, in he was talking to the French people and criticizing them, saying you guys don't respect freedom of religion. You force women to take off their hijab or their niqab, right? And so the French ambassador or whoever it was replied, and then Erdogan replied and said, in our country, when we see someone who's silly and dumb, we call them a Frenchman, right? I mean, he says this in front of the UN. I mean, the Muslims look at that and they feel pride. They feel empowered, subhanAllah. And in the end, he's a descendant of these people. Maybe not a direct descendant, but, you know, of them. So, inshallah, it's a hot topic now. People really care about it, and they want to learn more about it. And perhaps that has to do with the fact that Turkey is doing very well, at least in our eyes. Wallahu ta'ala alam. So, we can stop there for Q&A, inshallah.
So, going back to the Salafis.
Mm-hmm.
Was there a conflict between the Salafis and the Sufis? When you said you, in one of the notes, I was trying
right.
to
understand. So the term Salafi, I think, is more recent than this time. Mm. Didn't come out until after this time. Although Salafism really goes back to Ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn Qayyim, who go back to the Salaf. So that's where the term Salafi comes from. These are people who are trying to understand Islam through the lens and through the ideologies of the first three generations, right? No one's going to deny that. Not even Sufis would deny that. Or not even scholars outside of the Salafi movement, right? But that's where the origins come from. So Ibn Taymiyyah is probably the head figure of Salafism of today, but he's not the one, we can't say he's the one who invented it. Does that make sense?
Because, you know, this term is used now very freely with the Saudis. They say, well, yes, the Salafis.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, of course, even the Wahhabi has become distorted to the point where people think that's a terrible thing.
Right. So I'll talk about the Wahhabis once we get to the 18th century.
You hear some of the sheikhs and Salafis, you know, they're very proud. They say, we are Salafi, and we're very proud of being the Salafi.
Right.
Because I think they're going back to this original idea of the first three centuries of
right.
Islam.
Right. Yeah. So today there is a lot of friction between Salafis and Sufis, right? But again, if you remember when we talked about Sufism, the beginning of Sufism back in the third century, the third or fourth century, the Sufis were Hanbalis. The Hanbalis were Sufis. Right? Now today it's seen as the arch enemies of the Sufis are the Hanbalis, the Salafis. Right? So these dynamics change. But the one who is able to take the most out of all of this is the one who's able to reconcile between that which is correct and that which is incorrect on both sides. Right? Salafism today is not, they lack a lot of insight. I'm talking about the movement as a whole. Once you get to the particular scholars, it's different. You know, scholars speak at a certain level, and then the general populace of a group speaks at a different level. Right? So perhaps we can talk more about that once we get to Wahhabism in the 18th century.
It's an interesting dynamic.
It is an interesting dynamic, and it's good to know.
You know, most of the Muslim influence in the Indian subcontinent, India and Pakistan, was because of the Sufis, or the people who called themselves Sufis. No, I mean,
right.
Or others called them Sufis. I don't know what, maybe they didn't call themselves Sufis, but they appealed to a certain mindset of the local people, and they were able to influence and convert vast numbers of people in that subcontinent.
The Sufis or the
Sufis?
The Sufis. Sufis, right.
Yeah.
The Sufism is very effective in that it's...
And to this day, actually. To this day,
right.
There are non-Muslims who go to these shrines.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's another subject. That's another, you know, that's also un-Islamic to some extent. I mean, this is very, very absurd. But they still do. And they have very strong affinity for the Hindus,
right.
The Buddhists, and all. They go to these Sufi shrines, quote unquote. I don't know for what. Maybe they go and pray or whatever they have to do there, you know.
It's funny because when you talk about converts here in America, a white convert tends to go to Sufism, and a black convert tends to go to Salafism. Why? Because it's appealing, right? You know, our black brothers and sisters they're dealing with a particular reality where it requires them to be tough and direct to meet people, right? And to be aggressive. And Salafism really promotes that, or at least Salafism today. Whereas white people, they're, you know, coming from Christianity and the type of polite society, as you know, modernity calls it, Sufism focuses on akhlaq, you know, manners and ethics, a little bit more than Salafism. So they find that more appealing.
Yes, there's one in Santa Barbara called Sufi Sam. It's a big...
Sufi Sam?
Sufi Sam. Sufi Sam is a very famous guy. And he's got a huge, huge following.
Yeah.
I mean, there's thousands of people in Santa Barbara that are Muslim because of Sufi Sam.
It's appealing because it caters to the individual.
Yeah.
No. Other questions? Yes.
So why exactly did the Ottomans invade the Mamluk Sultanate?
To unite the Ummah again.
Okay.
Yes.
Regarding the bottom-up approaches from Ibn Taymiyyah, as you said, how successful they were in terms of uniting,
you know,
the Muslims?
I mean, it would be hard to say that Ibn Taymiyyah's impact began during his time. He did impact a lot of people, right? His thought process, his charisma was influential even to scholars, right? So someone like, for example, Ibn Khaldun, there is research that suggests, that theorizes, or the thesis is that Ibn Khaldun was heavily impacted by Ibn Taymiyyah. And they try and prove that. Imam al-Shatibi, right, who was in Andalus, very far from Ibn Taymiyyah, right? He has quoted Ibn Taymiyyah, large quotes, without, you know, ascribing to Ibn Taymiyyah because he was a controversial individual. So he was impactful in that regard. Now, was the Ummah unified by his work? I'd say the Ummah became unified through the Ottomans, somewhat, right? The Ottomans really made things, once they calmed things down quite a bit. And they had a very strong and good relationship with the Mughals, who were also Sunnis. And then between them were the Safavids, and we'll talk about this next week, inshallah. So I think, I mean, it's hard to determine. I can't really comment that much, but...
I mean, specific achievement or something that really outstanding?
His most outstanding achievement was, I think, his works in general. It said that, I think he's written 300 volumes. 300 volumes, that's fascinating. 200, 300 volumes. Right? That's a great accomplishment. His calling back to Tawheed, right? His courage to face certain issues that have become cultural. And by cultural, I don't mean necessarily outside of Islam or against Islam, but it's become like, okay, you just don't question this. And what's funny is that Ash-Shatibi, in the beginning of his book, Al-I'tisam, he mentions that culture has really taken over during his time in Andalus. And if anyone dared to challenge the culture, I mean, people revolted against that person. So he says that, I thought to myself, what should I do? Should I talk about this and whatnot? So he said, I gathered my heart and I spoke about it. I challenged the culture. And he says, people have revolted against me, right? So Ibn Taymiyyah had the courage to do it. He got him arrested 3 times. He got arrested by the Sufis. The Sufis who were close to the Sultan, you know, kept convincing the Sultan, you know, they actually wanted to execute him. Why? Over fatwas, in which he wasn't the first to say them. So you can see how ugly it can get.
Were these Mongols also Muslims at that time when you talked about the Ilkhanids?
Yes, they were Muslims, or they claimed to be Muslims,
Mongols
yes. They
were Muslims and they were trying to take Damascus from
yes.
Mm-hmm. The Seljuks or whatever, I don't know who was there.
Right. I think it was the Ayyubs or the Mamluks? The Mamluks.
Mamluks.
Yes, the Mamluks. So they claimed to be Muslim, at least the Ilkhanids claimed to be it. But Ibn Taymiyyah, when you look at his fatwa, he has 3 fatwas. I actually wrote a paper about this. He has 3 fatwas against them. And he does really attack them as being hypocrites. Not necessarily hypocrites in terms of their theology, but hypocrites in terms of the fact that they are simply out of line. Of they're not following wahi, revelation.
It was a power struggle.
It was a power struggle, yes. Yes. Ibn Taymiyyah caught that. The other scholars didn't. Why? Because he knew them. He gathered with them. He saw them. He had the courage to engage them. And what's interesting, Ibn Taymiyyah's history, his biography is very, very long. Right? Which shows you how his personality, his persona, how impactful it was to the people around him. His biography is like 700 pages long. Yeah. One of his students wrote it. Ibn Abdul Hadi.
And he was based where did he...
Damascus.
Damascus.
He was born in Harran, which is in present-day Turkey. And when they were young, the Mongols that came during that time, so the family fled to Damascus. Yes. He spent his early years in Damascus, and then he spent, I think, 10 to 12 years in Egypt. He was arrested there once because of his position in terms of Allah's names and attributes. And then he went back to Damascus, and then he was arrested for making the fatwa about the talaq. And then in the end of his life, he gave a fatwa that we are not allowed to go to the Prophet ﷺ's grave to visit the Prophet ﷺ as an act of worship. So some people, the Sufis, the reason they'd go to Medina, I mean, they'd go to travel to Medina just for the sake of visiting the Prophet ﷺ's grave. So he gave a fatwa against that, and he was arrested for that. By arrest, I don't mean he was put in a prison like today. He was put under house arrest in the qala, the fortress. Right, that's where he was. So he had a servant. His brother was serving him at the end of his days. The third time he was arrested. And he goes around in the fortress freely. Right? He had his water, he had his food and everything like that. But he was writing during that time, and then they took away his pen, and then he passed away shortly after.
But you know, what is interesting is that the Mongols, who were in the northern part of Central Asia, north of where the Seljuks were.
Mm-hmm.
Became Muslim, actually the first from the Golden Horde.
Yes.
His name was Berke Khan. He was the first Mongol Muslim commander, Muslim army, but he became Muslim.
Mm-hmm.
He helped the Seljuks actually. He then fought the Seljuks and helped the Seljuks to fight the Muslims who were coming north from the Ilkhanate.
Right. So there were alliances. I didn't mention this in the Mamluks. There were alliances between, sometimes the Mamluks would ally with Ilkhanids against someone, and sometimes the Golden Horde against the Ilkhanids. I mean, it was just politics. I mean, it gets a mess. It becomes a mess sometimes. Any other questions? وصلى الله على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. جزاكم الله خير.